Hi, this is Ford again. This is a series I've conceived to deal with perhaps the boredom that some of you might be feeling, or the lack of focus as we're in this pandemic lockdown. This is a Tsuba I conceived of about 10 years ago now in South Africa, and it has formed the basis of a couple of classes I've run. Participants in those classes had in some cases, no metalwork experience before, and yet everybody went through the process in about 3 days and ended up with a credible Tsuba at the end of it. The inspiration was the way Japanese potters who make the little teacups, how they work, and they mound up the clay into a hump, and then almost with one hand in about 15 seconds are able to shape up a teacup just in one effortless gesture, and then lift it off and there's a finished teacup. I love the idea of that degree of skill and understanding of material resulting in a finished object. Of course, with metalwork, especially something like a Tsuba that has a lot of demands and requirements, there's a lot more technique required. But I think there's a way, and that's why I developed this particular Tsuba, to create an art object that utilizes a very limited range of processes. The trick being that each layer, each step, each process is done very carefully and delicately to build up a skin, if you like, and an overall form. So I'm going to talk about the elements we're going to be working with. We'll talk briefly about the tools we'll be needing and the materials that you'll need to get hold of should you want to follow along. And then we'll dive in and deal with each step in much more detail. And at the end of it, hopefully, I'll have made a decent Tsuba and you can follow that process yourself. So we're going to be using copper plate, 3 millimeters thick. This is the optimum thickness for, I think, for piercing, cutting out, and we're going to thicken the edge so the piece will look more substantial, but a Tsuba doesn't have to be overly heavy. Tsuba that we used for practical purposes either had extensive piercings to lighten them, but like a racing car's wheel, or were thin and then had the edges thickened up to give them a substantial appearance. So we're going to be playing with that, actually, the web of the Tsuba, the plate, relatively thin, and then the edge thickened up. So that's the first principle. It sort of creates a framework. This copper plate I bought off eBay. In the UK, there's a metal supplier called Metals 4U. I'll put a link in the descriptor. I don't get any money from them, by the way. But you want 3 millimeter plate. This is an 8 centimeter or 80 millimeter square piece. I think it cost about £5, maybe $7. Really, if you are going to follow along, try to get 3 mil. You can do it thicker, but your piece will end up being a little bit more clunky and it'll be a little bit more awkward to push metal around. So I find this 3 mil is a good optimum thickness. So oftentimes it comes with protective plastic. If we take that off, if we can take it off, the metal underneath has been protected. Look at the whole point, of course. That's lovely. The other side, on the other hand, has just been bashed around in an engineering works. That's not as helpful. Before we proceed, once you've cut out the basic shape, that needs to be polished up with Scotchstone or something, because all those little marks will show up in the subtle textures we put on. So that's what we're starting with. 3 mil copper plate, 80 mil square. Right, the second aspect of the design of this piece, of course, is the shape. Now, I've helpfully made up some templates. We use these in class, and as I say, the PDF will contain them. You can print them off to actual size. I like to make my templates out of brass for the most part, although this one's copper. A 0.5 millimeter thick brass sheet is really useful. There's a number of shapes I'm providing. So this is your first aesthetic decision. What shape do you want? That's a sort of saddle flap shape. That's a little bit more round. You can see they're very subtle forms, but they do have different feelings to them. These are half templates because actually they're symmetrical. So you just flip them over the center line. I make a lot of my templates like this, so they're half templates. This obviously is an interesting one. These are Higo province style pieces, as is the overall aesthetic we're going with. It's a very abstract, earthy kind of feel that was very much favoured in the Edo period in the Higo province. So I'm playing with those ideas. So you've got to make a decision as to the shape you want. Once you've got the shape, you're going to put it onto your copper plate. Now, at this point, you've got to scribe around it. You're going to put it, and I'll use this one so it can show up better. You're going to put your template on your copper plate. Now, you're going to have to draw around it with a scriber. What I like to do, first of all, there's a center line on your template. You've drawn a center line on your piece very lightly because you don't want to leave the marks too heavily scribed. As I said, any marks will show up underneath the texture. So just a very light center line. Align your template to that line. And I like to use a clamp like this. This is a pretty strong one. Wolfcraft does this, but there are all sorts. A nice little spring-loaded clamp. And you pop it on. It's not moving anywhere. I use this quite a lot. Scriber, I actually do use a pin in a pin vise. You can use a pin in a piece of wood, any scriber you've got. Drawing around the piece and drawing the center line. Don't cut out the center hole at this point. Find your center point and punch a center hole. We'll get back to that in a minute because that's integral to the second layer of texture we're going to apply. So that's your first step. Choose your template, clamp it in position on a center line, draw around it. Right, so now you've scribed out your Tsuba on your blank. You've marked the center point. You need to drill a hole in that center point. I'm going to talk about that in a moment as to what that's for. You can either cut out your Tsuba the conventional way with a jeweler's saw. Of course, they didn't have saws in Japan up until the very late 19th century. So it would have been a series of holes drilled around and then broken off like a metal postage stamp and then chiseled up or filed up. So you can use a jeweler's saw. It's 3 millimeters thick. In fact, my bench guillotine works to chip this off. So I'll be cheating because I've got a guillotine. But then again, so did the Japanese metalworkers. They had very large shears clamped down and they could effectively do the same thing. So you're going to cut that out using a saw, or as I say, you have a guillotine. At that point, we're going to have to think about forging the plate to give it a texture. We want to give it a texture of some sort. Now you're going to need an anvil to work on. Of course, if you've got a smooth polished anvil and you're hammering a texture on one side, and then you flip it over and you hammer a texture the other side, the anvil is going to smooth it out. So you're kind of fighting yourself there. One alternative for an anvil is an old engineer's hammer. I've picked up many of these off eBay, and I'm sure many of you do have old hammers. These make really good impromptu anvils, by the way. So if you can't afford a big anvil, something like this. In fact, this one, I actually bought the head on its own for about $15. You could mount that in a block of wood, and you've got a little anvil. I tend not to polish them up for the most part. Although I lie, I've got a load of them, some are polished. This has got a nice stony finish. So that texture is great. And if I'm using another hammer that has a similar texture, the plate between is going to receive texture on both sides. So if we, that's our anvil. Now I've got a set of textured hammers. To be honest with you, I rarely, if ever, use these in my own work. These were made specifically for a class situation, and Bella actually nicks them off me and uses them when she has wedding ring making classes with her clients. I will do a separate film on how to make textured hammers. You've heard me say before, perhaps, I don't like the word texture in relation to metalwork. I prefer to think of it as creating a skin. So my textured hammers are designed to create an overall effect rather than individual marks. And the hammering technique we're going to develop, and this is one of the fundamental things this project's about, using the hammer effectively, So the texture blends in and creates a skin. There's a variety here. This is one I quite favor. It's sort of a linear face. These are engineer's hammers. I think I got these off eBay. There are a lot of knockoffs that are just nothing more than cast iron, and they're useless. But the German pattern engineer's hammer, I think these are 500 grams, so about a pound in weight. You need to soften them and then create your texture by whatever means. And you'll notice there's a soft cushion shape, so that when you're hammering very accurately onto the metal, you're not catching the edges. And we'll discuss it, obviously, when we get to that point. But these are, well, not complicated to make. If you don't have anything like this to hand, then you're going to have to be creative and find some way of creating a textured surface on your metal. Moving on, we've now got a plate that's got a nice texture on it, and it's cut out to the shape you wanted. And if you remember, there's a single hole in the center. Right, at that point, we have a Tsuba that needs a little bit more work. So using any of these templates, that's a funky one. These little templates, you'll notice there's a hole in the middle. There's your clue, your first clue. So I'm going to use this one just as an example. So that hole needs to correspond with the hole that you've drilled. What you can do then is you take your plate. We're going to take our plate, put it in pitch, put the drill bit in, or a similar piece of metal, and pop this little template on that pivot point. We can now rotate this all around the Tsuba, can't we? And that's the clever bit. Then, using a scraper with a little hook, it's a bit like a darning needle with a little hook. Again, when we get to the point where we're using this, we'll examine this more closely and talk about how you might make one. So we're going to use this, holding the template on the plate, the textured plate, and we're just going to drag it down like a little plow along that curve, and moving the template along, you can imagine immediately how that subtle overlay texture on the Tsuba was created. So that's the secret. You see this on a number of Higo period Edo, Higo province period pieces. So this is how it's actually done. If it's a straight line, radiating out from the center, that's called Amida Yasuri, the Amida being the radiant lines around the head of the Buddha. So this is how it's done. You can do it with a file, but most of them are done with a little scribing plow tool. I've turned this into a burnisher on the other side because you need a burnisher. So it's a double-ended handy tool. Once we've got a nice texture on our Tsuba and we've done the overlay pattern of the linear texture, we need to upset the rim of the Tsuba. So this is a hammer that I've gravitated towards over the last few years for general goldsmithing work. It took me a while to find one, or the right hammer rather, the right weight and proportions. This is an 8 ounce or 123, 130 something grams cross peen hammer. That's the cross peen there. And you see I've polished it up, it's smooth, that's kind of handy. And the face I've polished. These are vintage, I wouldn't bother buying new ones. The steel is often a bit rubbish, but it's 8 ounces, I find, is a really good weight for general goldsmithing work. And in this instance, it's actually a good weight to learn how to work the edge of the Tsuba. So you're going to be holding this on a block of wood, so it's supported. If you held this on metal, if you hammer here, the other side's going to get distorted. We don't want that. We only want to work where the hammer is so we can control things. We're going to go through a series of processes to upset the rim, to thicken it. That's going to give us a nice thickened ridge, and it's going to fold over and create a nice undulated inner edge, as you see in the original. As a consequence of hammering that, the inner side is sharp. We will then use the famed hisage, or as they say in Canada, the hissage. That's a joke. The hisage is a scraping tool. We will talk about this obviously when we get to it and how to make them and what the proper the angles are. And we use it on pivoting off the thumb, and we scrape the sharp edge on the inside away. This is a fairly fundamental technique, and this is a really good exercise in learning how to utilize this tool very effectively. Prior to the use of emery papers and so forth, this would have been used extensively in finishing bronzes and the like in both China and Japan and Korea in the ancient world. There are pieces I've seen from 2,000 years ago that have scrape marks on. So this is a pretty ancient tool, but very effective, and I think you'll enjoy getting to grips with this. At that point, having done the rim, cleaned up the edges, filed up the outside and prepared it for polish or burnishing, we then have to put in this central opening where the tang of the sword would go through, the nakago ana, or the tang hole. Again, another template is required. If you're ever going to make tsuba, you're going to need one of these. I've got a whole number of them. There's one in the PDF. Taking some time to make a really good one is worth the effort. That shape is really rather important. It's not just a mechanical opening, in my view. It adds to the overall aesthetic effect. So you'll put it on the center line in the correct position, mark it out as before with a clamp, hold it in place with a clamp rather, scribe it. Now you can cut that hole away because you've used it now and you don't need it any longer. File that up, and then any further openings that you may have on your template can be put in position and marked out, a hole drilled, pilot hole drilled, and cut out and shaped up. And that essentially is the tsuba made. And then to finish, we're going to use a flame, just a flame, no chemicals. The one that I made 10 years ago, that first one, that was just patinated with a torch. So we'll do that because not everybody has all the chemicals required. And that will be it.